Buenos días desde Dios.
Buenos días desde Dios.
Good morning. A warm word of welcome to you all to Second Presbyterian Church on this Pentecost Sunday. We welcome back Hillary Higgins and her musical gifts on the violin. Glad to have you with us. We would also especially like to welcome any guests or visitors that we have among us today. Our custom is if you feel comfortable, we'd invite you to stand, tell us your name, and where you're from. So do we have any guests or visitors with us this morning?
Bernard Higgins and Albert.
Bernard, glad to have you with us.
Yeah, Daddy!
If you feel like you recognize Bernard, there may be a reason for it. He was in the joint choir that we have sung together the last few years with Risen Savior Catholic Church as well. Are there others? Yes, Sarah.
My brother James is
singing
us all the way from Utah.
Jane?
Jane, very blessed to be with both my grandmas today.
Grandmother Jane from Utah, welcome. Glad to have you with us. And of note, if anyone's wondering where Tessie Lopez is, she is not in the balcony. We will be praying for her because she has hurt her knee, and so she'll probably have to sit down below for a while. But we pray that she heals soon. So, welcome. Anybody else? Well, I'm going to go ahead and highlight just a few announcements this morning. The first is we have two events going on tomorrow night, almost at the same time. The young adults will be meeting at Kendra and Michael Rubio's home tomorrow. Kendra's right there if you want to talk to her, to RSVP, or you might have gotten an email as well. And that's at 6:30, whereas at 7 p.m., the Presbyterian women will be gathering. Is that here at the church, Presbyterian women?
Yes.
That will be here in the fellowship hall. And there will be a CPR training led by Chris Johnson. So many of you are invited to those events. Tuesday is our stated session meeting, so we'll see many of you here, 5:15 for dinner, 6 p.m. for the meeting. And also, bittersweet, next Sunday is my last Sunday here for 3 months during sabbatical, and the church kindly is going to have a potluck, so hope to see many of you at that as well. The gorgeous flowers today to my left and to my right are given by the worship committee in the spirit of Pentecost. I just want to lift up joy and for all of the graduates. There's many names you'll see in the bulletin, and we'll have some honoring this morning, so I call that to your attention. And last but not least, as you look at the prayer list, and I know many of you pray for those on the prayer list, I would add Camino de Vida Church. Today they are celebrating their 8th anniversary, and in fact, several folks from our congregation are actually worshiping over there with them today. Let's pray for the Laguna Worship Community. The Reverend Dr. Kay Huggins is preaching there today, and a contingency from Second Press has also gone to worship there. So you're everywhere today. Isaac, are you here? On the 16th, Isaac turned 16, so happy birthday to Isaac. And just as he's starting to stop blushing, Jasmine, if you want to start blushing, today is Jasmine's 14th birthday. Happy birthday to you both. Just a prayer concern to lift up. Some of you might be members of neighborhood apps in your computer that kind of keeps you in touch with what's going on in your neighborhood, goods and bads. And over on Walter, actually kind of near San Ignacio Catholic Church, for several nights over the last couple weeks, there's been gunshots going off in the evening. And I don't think anyone's been hurt that they know of, but it obviously concerns a lot of people in the neighborhood. So let's pray for the neighborhood. And then prayers for many of the other Lopez family who are on a trip to Yellowstone, which constitutes many folks from the church. So please keep them in your prayers. And last but not least, Ruth Montoya was hospitalized last week. She is back home. She's been given a clean bill of health, but emailed that she still doesn't have enough energy to come to church today, though she will try to make it to session. So if we can keep her in our prayers. Yes, Mary. Mary Montoya from the Presbyterian Women wants to clarify that that gathering tomorrow is not just for Presbyterian women. It's open to anyone in the church. And with regards to learning CPR, the more people that are trained in that, certainly the better. Brothers and sisters, yes, Martha.
Well, we want them to be familiar with the AED, the emergency. emergency.
Defibrillator.
The defibrillator. That's what we want everybody to become familiar with.
Okay. Martha has an addendum to Mary's addendum, which is we also have a defibrillator just around the corner, and the more that people can know how to use that, the better. We know we had an episode of church pretty recently, and that's just a reminder that we can all work together to help prevent anything from happening we wouldn't want to happen. Any other announcements? Yeah. Happy birthday to Barbara, who turned 96 yesterday. Feliz cumpleaños.
Don. I just wanted to announce that the banners on both sides were designed by Don Trujillo. Next Sunday, Trinity Sunday, we'll have banners that she also designed. And also that Ava McBride is not here, is the one who's responsible for the banners outside.
In reverse order, the banners that you've seen changing periodically during the seasons outside, Abel and Alma McBride are responsible for those banners. They've had them designed, put them together, so that's something to thank them for. And then I didn't quite hear you. Who designed the banners inside? Alma Trujillo. So, oh, the outside banner. Okay, the two out here are designed by Thelma Trujillo. Thank you, Thelma.
Next Sunday, the ones there.
And last but not least, so you can have peace of mind as we worship, we've got this right here with the cameras. Normally, as we acknowledge that our hearts are prepared and our minds are prepared to worship the living God, we all stand together and sing, but this morning, please remain seated and the young folk will sing to us.
Because it is Pentecost Sunday, we wanted to do a song in African for you. It's an African welcoming song, and during the song you will see, we welcome you with our thoughts, we welcome you with our words, we welcome you from our hearts, and we have nothing up our sleeve.
Funga alapia, ashe, ashe. 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 Funga alapia, ashe, ashe.
Thank you.
join me in the call to worship, translation of Psalm 8. O Lord, how manifold are your works, all creation waits for you. When you hide your face, they are dismayed.
When you send forth your spirit, they are brand new again.
You renew the face of the earth.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever.
With my whole being, I will bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord.
O Señor, cuán múltiples son mis obras. Toda la creación te espera. Cuando escondes tu cara, están consternados. Renuevas la faz de la tierra. Con todo mi ser, bendeciré al Señor.
Bendice al Señor, alma mía, alabar al Señor.
Can I have the children and youth please join me up here? Okay, it's been a busy month, hasn't it? Come on down, everybody. So, it's been a busy month. We had Mother's Day last Sunday, and then school will be out soon. Right? And you'll be in, no, not for some of you, okay. And you'll be enjoying the summer, but you'll enjoy the summer anyway, right? Okay, have a seat, sweetie. Okay, and then you know what else? There was a royal wedding yesterday. How many of you watched that? I watched a few minutes. And we're recognizing the graduates today. And after the children's moment, we have graduates from high school and from college also. And today is Pentecost Sunday. Raise your hand if you know what Pentecost Sunday is all about. Okay, well, we're going to give you a little lesson in a little bit. But as you can see, the church is adorned with flowers and red candles, red flowers, because the theme of Pentecost is red. And look at all around, look at all the people that have red on, and a lot of you do. All right? Well, we're going to talk about Pentecost. Now, this was a very special time in the Bible when the disciples and followers of Jesus received the Holy Spirit, as Jesus had promised. And we will be hearing scripture today from the book of Acts, Acts 2, 1 through 21, that is going to talk about the upper room and when these people received the Holy Spirit. Now, we're going to imagine in a little bit what it was like to be in that upper room and for that Holy Spirit. When God makes his presence, it is spectacular, and that's what happened in the upper room. By the way, the Chavez family, when they were in Israel, they visited the upper room, and I think the Holy Spirit must have been moving Emiko and Diego because they started wrestling. So I think the Holy Spirit really moved through them. Okay, now I'm going to give these out to a few people because we're going to need some fire, and you're going to hold. Okay, there's one there. And you want to do one? And when I tell you, there it is. A couple more. Can you pass one back there? You want to do one? Caroline? Thank you. Okay. So imagine that the people were gathered in the upper room, and then there was a mighty wind. Okay. And then came bits of fire. Put that fire up there. Okay. And then different languages were spoken. together again. Rushing wind, fire, lift the fire above the head, and different languages. Okay. Do you get that? Do you feel, can you imagine what it was like being in that upper room? Everyone could understand what was being said, regardless of what language was being spoken, because there was a lot of people there from different places that spoke different languages. The people were confused at first, but then they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were filled with joy and with love. And the Holy Spirit didn't just come that day and go away. The Holy Spirit lives in our hearts today. We can't see the Holy Spirit, but inside we have a feeling, a good feeling in us, a feeling of love that guides us in decisions we have to make, comforts us, and calms our fears. The Holy Spirit fills us with love and hope and brings us closer to God. I think it's like a power source, and it's exciting to have the Holy Spirit with us. And that's why we celebrate Pentecost. So I can take your fire right now and just put it right there. Thank you for being good listeners and being helpful today. So can we bow our heads and pray? Thank you, sweetie. Yes. Very good. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending the Holy Spirit that lives within our hearts, that brings us joy and comfort. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our first hymn this morning is Spirit of Gentleness. It's in the Red Glory to God hymnal, number 291. Oh, and we will be singing that right after we recognize the graduates, Suzy Chang and Anita Van.
The fear that you have when you're in the hospital or whatever, make them feel comfortable. They all have gifts. They all have potential. Wherever they end up, it'll be good, I know. But as with, you know, any kind of going forward stuff, there's always bumpy roads. And I have a gift for you that's probably going to be the best the best gift you're going to get for graduation. Truly, no matter what you get, money, whatever you get, this is the best gift. And you're going to think, boy, is she lame. Because it's a bookmark. But it's a special bookmark. I had to order these special because if you keep it for the rest of your life, it tells you where to have a conversation with God. If you're worried about friendship, if you're worried about money, if you're stressed, if you're not feeling love, if all the different things that happen in life, if you've taken a path that you don't want to be on and you need to get back on the right path, this tells you the feeling that you're having, and it tells you where to talk to God in the Bible about that feeling. It helps you keep on the right path, no matter where you're at. So I'm hoping that this little gem, this treasure that you have for the rest of your life, you're going to keep it in a special place, probably in your Bible, but not necessarily. You might keep it in your underwear drawer so that you see it every day, your sock drawer. You might put it on the refrigerator, but make sure you don't lose it because it is a treasure. Because each and every one of you are a treasure. There was an article in today's paper that said the people that are most happy in the world are the people that go to church. Hopefully, you will go to church wherever you're at and keep that community, keep that conversation with God going. I'm so proud of all of you.
To second Presbyterian, you are a treasure, and we just are always are glad to see our youth here, and we give a card to you every year. It's not something you want to keep in your underwear drawer. But here's your card from second Presbyterian, and we hope to see you back anytime. And good luck. More graduates, and you guys can stay here. Andrew Zamora, he graduated from El Dorado High School, and he is Sam and Ella's grandson. Eden Gallegos, she graduated from Houston Homeschool, and she is Yvonne Gallegos' granddaughter. Vivek Ravishanka, he graduated from the University of Maryland with a mechanical degree. He is Rick and Marie Kennedy's grandson. Sierra Sanchez graduated from Manchester Community College. And she has got a degree in nursing, and she also is Rick and Marie Kennedy's grandchild. Yeah. Christina Villarreal graduated from New Mexico State University with a Bachelor of Science in Education, and she is Art and Thelma's granddaughter. Aaron Chavez graduated from UNM Law School, and she is Beverly Chavez's daughter. And also Hunter Hanacek graduated from Gilbert High School, and he is Sam and Ella Braga's grandson. Thank you.
after the next year.
You may remember that hymn we talked about a while back, Spirit of Gentleness. Let's go ahead and sing it now. Number 291 in the red Glory to God hymn.
Spirit, días es de Dios.
Buenos días.
Please join me in the prayer of the day in Spanish.
Dios, creador nuestro, la tierra tiene muchos lenguajes, pero tu evangelio proclama tu amor en un lenguaje celestial. Danos poder con el lenguaje de amor para que a través del poder de tu espíritu nuestras palabras construirán unidad en nuestra comunidad, nuestra nación, nuestro mundo, a través de tu Hijo Jesucristo, nuestro Señor, quien vive y reina contigo y el Espíritu Santo, un Dios, ahora y siempre.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of illumination in both languages. Come, Holy Spirit, come like the wind of heaven, unseen, unbidden. Come like the dawn, illuminating the world. Come with courage and with challenge. Come with strength beyond our everyday resources. Come near to us, Holy Spirit, that we may hear, believe, and be heard.
From the second chapter of Acts, verses 1 through 21. Listen to God's word to your heart and soul. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other languages.
Según el Espíritu les concedía expresarse, estaban de visita en Jerusalén judíos piadosos procedentes de todas las naciones de la tierra. Al oír aquel bullicio, se agolparon y quedaron todos pasmados porque cada uno los escuchaba hablar en su propio idioma. Desconcertados y maravillados decían, ¿no son galileos todos estos que están hablando? ¿Cómo es que cada uno de nosotros los oye hablar en su lengua materna? Partos, medos y elamitas, habitantes de Mesopotamia, de Judea y de Capadocia, del Ponto y de Asia, de Frigia y Panfilia, de Egipto y de las regiones de Libia, cercanas a Cirene, visitantes llegados de Roma, judíos y proselitos, cretenses y árabes, todos por igual los oímos proclamar en nuestra propia lengua las maravillas de Dios.
All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others sneered and said, they are filled with new wine. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, men of Judea, and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Esta es la palabra de Dios.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be blessed by your Spirit on this morning. Amen. We who live in the United States live in a period of unprecedented choice. And that sense of choice goes along with a growing sense of autonomy as individuals, as something that has been growing over the centuries. For most of human history, one's life position, one's access to material things, is normally quite controlled and limited. But today, things are different. Though choice and access are not equally distributed in our country, the reality is we do have a lot of choice when it comes to how we spend our lives and what goods and services we seek to acquire. And in fact, in some cases, we have so much choice, it can become crippling. I recall one time speaking with Pastor Guillermo Yella, and he shared about when he in Syria took a Cuban couple who had recently left their country and moved to Albuquerque. They took them shopping at a supermarket. Now, you may know that in Cuba, material goods are phenomenally scarce. Basic staples are distributed by ration cards, and stores often run out of products. As Guillermo and Celia led the family through the supermarket, the Cubans were so overwhelmed by the choices, they were paralyzed. 30 types of cereal, 10 brands of ham, they could not even make sense of it. A choice is both a blessing and a curse. The notion of choice overload is not something new. It can be traced back to Aristotle, Ortega, and to the French philosopher Jean Buridan. Buridan theorized that faced with the choice of two equally tempting options, such as a donkey choosing between two piles of delicious hay, the choice is delayed. We think about it. This is sometimes referred to as Buridan's ass, as the ass not able to choose between the two in the theorem dies of hunger. This is also a reminder of how not making a choice is a choice. Now, one of the consequences of our choice-rich society is the privilege of customization. We're all different. We all have different tastes and needs, and the youngest generations know this more than any. They are programmed to customize the things that they buy, their clothes, their video games, their computers, their sports equipment, and when they get older, their cars, just about anything. And when we as adults have the resources, we can buy and customize our material goods to our lives in a way that is unprecedented. But as the saying goes, there are two sides to every coin. What a privilege it is to have the luxury to be able to make so many choices about the directions of our lives and the nature of our possessions. Many people who do not share that privilege wish for it. There are some pretty cool things about customization and the autonomy we enjoy. It certainly engenders a sense of control and freedom and shaping our identities to the world around us in ways that we choose rather than having those identities forced upon us by society. And now our society values autonomy and life customization and holds them up as ideals. But there is a cautionary side that often gets lost in our hyper-consumeristic society. For example, an enhanced sense of control can cause us to think we have more control over life than we really do. Too many choices and too much autonomy can be paralyzing, as mentioned. And a lot of choice and autonomy can be very unsatisfying. As author Barry Schwartz writes, when people have no choice, life is almost unbearable. But as the number of choices keep growing, negative aspects of having a multitude of options begins to appear. The negatives escalate until we become overloaded. At this point, choice no longer liberates, but debilitates. And that quote is from Schwartz's book called The Paradox of Choice. But why all this talk about autonomy and choice? I will hopefully answer that question. But first, let's examine the Pentecost passage that Carla and I read. Today, Pentecost Sunday, we recognize that fateful day 2,000 years ago, suddenly from heaven there came the sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them the ability. In that time and place, the promise of the coming of the Holy Spirit recorded in the Old Testament was fulfilled. Oftentimes, Pentecost is called the birthday of the church. This presumes that Pentecost set in motion the spreading of the established church that was in Jerusalem and moving it out to the rest of the world. And Peter's words in response to Pentecost event are sometimes called the first sermon in church history. Now, this miraculous event implies quite a few things. It is a fulfillment of Jesus promising to leave behind an advocate, his Spirit, according to John 14:6, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. Pentecost also is the establishment of sort of a new age of relating to God. The Holy Spirit's presence presents new ways of understanding God and living out faith. But 2,000 years later, we notice something unique about our faith in the presence of the Holy Spirit. It is something about God, something about us. As Kay mentioned last Wednesday in her Bible study, the gospel is intended to attend to current needs. In other words, the gospel's power is not locked to a 2,000 years ago, but in its timeless nature, along with the assistance of the Spirit, the good news is applicable and understandable to different times and contexts. The Pentecost even demonstrates the amazing power of God to reach our hearts, no matter what language we speak or what culture we come from. It is a reminder of the multicultural nature of faith. Much of the book of Acts is the account of how the good news that was first received in Jewish culture spread to the Gentiles. Paul reminds us that there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Pentecost is an event that shows how the good news can translate beyond the boundary of every culture and language, and even find its way through the particularities of an individual directly into his or her heart. In fact, if we think about it, Pentecost shows us the Spirit has the ability to customize faith to each culture, to each individual. There are Christians throughout the world in various countries and cultures, and yet in spite of differences, we are all bound together by faith. And in our nation, the faith is spread. It's spread out from sea to shining sea. It has reached the hearts of the privileged and the poor, folks from every walk of life and in different cultural enclaves. Christianity can customize to our realities. Now let's go back to that previous discussion about autonomy and choice. We could find ourselves thinking, how great thou truly art, O Lord. I can customize you to my personal life that I value so much. I can melt you and mold you so you can fill me and use me. I can maintain my immense autonomy, and I can choose how to fit God into my life the way I best see fit. I can customize my faith. What an incredible God. But lest we forget, as nice as autonomy and choice can be, there is a cautionary side of that coin. Perhaps you've heard about the Saddleback Church pastor and author Rick Warren and his bestseller, The Purpose-Driven Life. Have you heard of that book? Whether or not you resonate with his writing or thinking about faith, the first line of The Purpose-Driven Life is a critical cautionary reminder that for the faithful, if we lose sight of it, in a way our faith is lost. Does anyone recall the first line of that book? Anyone who can come up with it will get to go to the front of the line during the fellowship hour. Okay. First line of this book, it's not about you. not about you challenges the premium we place on our autonomy and our beloved power of choice. But it is at the heart of faith. Though Pentecost reminds us that God's love, truth, and spirit are malleable enough to fit the contours of all cultures, languages, and hearts, we must remember that life, purpose, faith, our journeys, our hope, our love, all of the deep realities that compose who we are not first about us. They pertain first to a greater reality. The story of the gospel is not a story that fits into our lives. Our lives are stories that fit into the bigger reality of God. If reality were a solar system, the world is not the sun that revolves around us. God is the center around which our lives revolve around. Now that is not to make us feel little, though it is meant to provide a healthy dose of humility. We are all vulnerable creatures. All of God's creation retains God's image, God's imprint. All of us are deeply loved and valued by God. But God is the end all and the be all, the Alpha and the Omega. There's a fine line between treating God as the totem upon which we project what we want to see, rather than us subjecting our perceived wants, needs, and desires to the God of the universe. The ego can be incredibly deceptive in each one of us, and it can convince us of many great things about ourselves while neglecting the importance of others and of God. Sometimes folks juxtapose the Pentecost event with the Tower of Babel story in the Old Testament. That's a helpful comparison. The Tower of Babel was an attempt of a people that all spoke one language to construct an edifice reaching all the way to heaven so that the people could make a name for themselves. You'll recall what happened when God sees this taking place. He sees their ambition to make themselves as important as God. So God scatters the people and divides their one language into many. In the words of author Kevin Van Hooser, it is well known that Pentecost reverses Babel. The people who built the Tower of Babel sought to make a name and a unity for themselves. At Pentecost, God builds his temple, uniting people in Christ. On this Pentecost Sunday, as we celebrate the gift of the Spirit, let us be mindful that its ultimate purpose is not to be shaped for us, but to shape our lives with the good news of the gospel. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Spirit now.
understand the body and the spirit as we together affirm our faith. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere and giver and renewer of our God. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith, sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the Church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of peoples long silence, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new creation and new birth. Pray, come, Lord Jesus. Please be seated. God has showered us with the Spirit. God has created us, redeemed us, and given us so much. Let us share our love and spirit and what we have been given for the work of the community and the Church.
Thank you.
Espíritu Santo, te damos gracias porque tú fluyes en nuestras vidas como el viento. Nos guías, nos das fuerzas y nos das sabiduría. Te pedimos que bendigas a las ofrendas para tu gloria y para tu honra. Amén. This time I would invite you to lift up any prayers that you would have for the community or for the world. I would like to add one this morning, and that is for Elizabeth and Randall Flynn Corver, the parents of Jude. And many of you know Elizabeth was due a couple of days ago. So we pray for her baby to come and for the whole family. Yes. Flynn.
I would like prayers for my friend who just passed away on Monday, Peggy Miller, and her family. She has a niece and a brother, and she was very peaceful. So we're grateful because she had quite a few medical problems.
Lynn lifts up the family of Peggy Miller and her prayers. Peggy was a dear friend to Lynn, and thankful that she could go peacefully. But of course, there's a lot of sadness and mourning, so we'll pray for you.
A joy. One of my cousins, his name is Marquise Pena, just graduated from medical school at UNM, and what's really amazing is that he grew up in a family with 9 children and very poor, and he's made it this far. He's not going to practice. He's going to medical school 5 more years to become a surgeon, and we're really proud of him.
Prayers of joy. Sandra's cousin, Marquise Pena, who had 8 siblings growing up and grew up in a pretty humble situation, just graduated from UNM Med School, will be going on to do further studies to become a surgeon. So prayers of joy and gratitude for that wonderful event. Dad?
Well,
it's
been good to pray for my friends, Jack and Penny, and remember, who just had one thing after another, nothing.
We have had on our prayer list Jack, Penny, Dormore. They've been a couple that have in recent years faced a lot of challenges, and Penny was just diagnosed with brain cancer. So please pray for their family. Thank you. Yes, Anna.
Prayers for my niece, Victoria, as she mourns the loss of her 17-year-old daughter, Deanna, in Texas.
Prayers for Anna's niece, Victoria, as she mourns the loss of her 17-year-old daughter. She was having a procedure in the hospital, and some infection or something was caused, and she passed away. And I know Anna and Jack and Luella went down to Dallas for her service, so prayers for the family, as I'm sure they are very much reeling. Yes, Amanda.
Prayers for Joey's
stepdad,
Pablo. He had a meeting on Monday.
Continue prayers for Joey's stepdad, Pablo. He just had a feeding tube put in. Don't know how many days he's going to be with us, but prayers for him and for the entire family. Are there any others? Yes, Tina.
We have lots of Joys this month. It was Joanne's birthday on the 17th. Gary's birthday was on the 15th, and my grandson turns 3 on Friday. And, also concerns for my Aunt Lena and my Uncle Richard, who was in the hospital this past week but from dehydration and his diabetes, but is doing much better.
Some birthday joys in the family, including Joanna and Gary and
Jason.
And Jacob's grand, or son Jacob, who just turned 3.
Yeah, Jacob Jr.
Jacob Jr. And then continued prayers for Lena, who I had a chance to go see this week. And she sends her greetings and love to the congregation. And then prayers also for Richard Martinez, Tina's uncle, who had some complications with diabetes and some dehydration and was hospitalized this week. Doing better, but we will check in with him and keep him in our prayers. Carmen.
I promised a granddaughter in Scotland that I would ask you pray mightily for the national test she's taking. I'm just fulfilling.
Carmen prays for her granddaughter in Scotland who's going to, is it one of the national tests?
It's the national test that determines whether or not she gets into the university system there for medical.
Who will be taking one of those tests that sometimes you take in Europe that kind of determine your future steps, and she would like to go to medical practice and study. So we will let her know we prayed for her.
She believes you guys pray better than most of you.
Sandra, go ahead.
I forgot what Sandra Durant's birthday is on Saturday.
This coming?
Yes.
Okay. We will wish Sandra Durant a happy birthday this coming Saturday. So, yeah, it's your turn. When is it? Is it today?
Thursday.
Okay. The past or the coming?
This coming Thursday.
This coming Thursday, we will say happy birthday to Frank Salasai. Happy birthday, Frank.
Continue
prayers for Reverend Quinones, whose most recent encounters with physicians have been a little more positive than a week before. Jordan, did you know?
She's doing better, but it's
going to
be a long haul.
Okay. Continue prayers for Dora's brother, and perhaps some prayers we need to be doing for a long period of time as he gets slowly gets better.
Prayers for
Ace,
for
prayers for Layla and Desiree as they will be moving to Hobbs, and prayers that they can grow with a planted. Yes, Lynn.
And we also send out prayers to the people in Santa Fe, Texas.
Mm-hmm. Prayers to the Santa Fe, Texas, High School, Texas community, and all of the rashes of these types of incidents that are now way too many, once is too many times, but happening way too many times. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. O Holy Spirit, source of creation, come to any of us who are ill or in trouble. Heal us in body, mind, and spirit, that we may return to life abundant. O Holy Spirit, mind of God, come to those in power. Enlighten their minds with your mercy and your wisdom, that their work may reflect and extend your will for all of creation. O Holy Spirit, presence of Christ, come to those you call your own. Enlighten their minds with your grace and your truth, that we may be your hands and your feet in the world to love. O Holy Spirit, comforter and companion, come to us all. Guide our actions, our words, that we may rejoice in your presence and make this world your own. O Holy God, whose Father, Son, and Spirit, we pray these prayers. We pray the prayers that were just spoken aloud, and we pray the prayers that are in our hearts, as we pray with you the prayer that you taught us, saying, Padre nuestro, que estás en los cielos, santificado sea tu nombre, venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad, como en el cielo, así también en la tierra. Pan nuestro de cada día, danos hoy, y perdónanos nuestras deudas, como también nosotros perdonamos a nuestros deudores, y no nos dejes caer en tentación, mas líbranos del mal, porque tuyo es el reino, y el poder, y la gloria, por todos los siglos. Amen. Our closing hymn, Showers of Blessing, Dios nos ha dado promesa, is in the Blue Spanish Hymnario, number 176, 176.
Mm-hmm.
hermanos y hermanas, que la gracia de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, que el amor abundante de Dios y que la comunión del Espíritu Santo sean con nosotros hoy, día y siempre. And all God's people say.
Amen.